good time. Put a smile on your face, yeah. KBK and Elation Radio. Even brighten your day and help you through the night. Bring you good music. KBK and Elation Radio. And here's your host.
Come on, everybody, give God a praise in the temple. Tonight we have a prayer. You know you need a word from the Lord. Lift your hands in His atmosphere and say, Lord, speak to me. Come on, fellowship, help me say, Lord, give us a word. Give us a word. World's in trouble, Lord. Give us a word. Our families are in trouble, Lord. Give us a word. As we surrender ourselves unto you, we say all we need. Just one word. Join in with the worship, everybody. Lift your hands and say, Lord, give us a word. Come on, let's sing. Give us a word. God, our lives are going to be better when you speak to us. Hallelujah. Our children are coming home when you speak to us. Know it by now. Come on, say all we need. Come on, say it. Say it till you believe it.
Just one word from you.
Come on, just lean on him and say all we need.
All we need.
Just one word.
Just one word from you.
This is what the Lord promised that you would. You know, things are getting better for you. Things are getting better for me. Somebody just wave back at me and say, I know that's right. I know that's right. You promised you would. You got it by now. You got it by now. Come on, lift your hands and say,
all.
One word.
Just one word from you.
Grab your neighbor by the hand and say, things are getting better, things are getting better, things are getting better, because
all we need,
just one word.
Just one word.
Come on, stand up on your feet. I need about three more people to stand up on your feet and help me say, you promised you would. Come on, point up to heaven. A sign of victory and say, you promised you would heal my land.
You would heal our land.
Somebody's singing it like you really believe it. Come on, say, you promised you would. Look at your neighbor and say, I see things are getting better for you. Come on, say, all I need is just one word. Just one word.
Just one word.
Doesn't matter what the doctor says. Doesn't matter what the lawyer says. But all I need is just one word.
All I need.
Just one word.
Just one word from you.
Things are getting better for me. I feel it all in my body.
I'm going to sing a song for you. Well, praise the Lord tonight. Amen. We thank God for another Tuesday night. Matter of fact, we thank God for Tuesday, February, amen, the 23rd. And tonight, God is going to bless us once again in this 90 minutes of word power tonight, known as The Voice. And I am your host, Apostle Vincent L. Smith. And the Lord bless you on tonight. And we thank God for you. We look to have a blessed and glorious and anointed time as we bless the word of God with you tonight. Let me take, amen, a ride around the country. Amen. I feel like taking a ride out to St. Louis. Let me see. I got enough gas. Let me go to St. Louis and see if I can catch up with Kimmy Kim.
Hello, this is a great day, and I'm going to continue on rejoicing in the Lord. And how you doing?
All is well. All is well.
Awesome.
Thank God for you tonight. Amen. I want to take another ride. Let me ride through, amen, Indianapolis, Indiana, and let me see, amen, if the evangelist Anna Henderson is doing well tonight. Are you with us tonight? All right, she has not tuned in as of yet, or even she has a phone on mute and can't get through. Amen. But either way, we thank God for her. All right, I feel like driving on a little further. Amen. I'm going to cut cross country, go on down in the Southland. There's a man down there selling peach pie. Amen. Apostle Urban Widow, are you with us tonight?
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom the Lord has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. The Lord bless you, Apostle. We are excited to be here on The Voice with you, looking forward to what the Lord is going to say and do.
Amen. Thank God. Thank God for you. Amen. Then I'm going to ride on up the way, and let me see. I feel like stopping in Upper Marlboro. Amen, Maryland, on this journey. Amen, Bishop Desmond Ernest E. Richard. He's looking out the window. It's not Jehovah's Witness, it's me. Glory to God. Are you on the line with us tonight? All right. I'm hearing silence for him thus far. Unless he's on mute, but we thank God for him. He'll probably call in before we get too far in. Amen. So we thank God tonight. Now let me check. I put a call out for some special guests tonight. Let me see if they're online with me. Amen. Both of these are my nephews. That's what I call them. Amen. And I want to see if either one of them are online with us tonight. Amen. Prophet John Leach, are you with us tonight? All right. We don't hear from him yet either. Amen. And then Prophet Orlando Marquez, are you with us on tonight? Okay, look like a lot of people taking the night off tonight. All right, but we're going to go ahead in Jesus' name. And we thank God for you all that have tuned in by gospel shoe and the gospel string. Amen. Whatever the name of all the media that we are using is, we thank God for you, you, and especially you for taking the time and being a part of this podcast. Amen. Last week, for the last few weeks, we have been talking about the prophet. That we have been in discussion about the work, the character, amen, the anointing of the prophet. And we got something good for you tonight. Just say, man, get yourself ready, because it's going to be a shocker and it's going to bless your very life tonight. Amen. Apostle Whitlow, if you will lead us in prayer tonight, amen, and then Kimmy Kim, if you can give us a backdrop from last week, I really appreciate it.
Father, in the matchless name of Jesus, once again, we come to tell you thank you for your grace, your love, your kindness towards us. Thank you for this opportunity to share of your word. We pray for those who are listening that, Father, they will hear the truth, and the truth will make them free. Not only that, but they will receive faith. But we understand that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So we pray that you cause your people to hear you more clearly, love you more dearly, walk with you more nearly, reverence you more fearly. In the name of Jesus, bless those who are in attendance tonight. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Kimmy Kim, can you give us a little backdrop from last week?
I believe last week we were talking about holiness. And we were saying that some people are sent, some people are went, and, you know, you have to be careful about your calling. You have to make sure that you are called to do a certain role. And when you are called, you do have that anointed. God does give you enough strength to endure your task. And it was a very enlightening conversation on last week. And so I hope I did well.
Amen, amen. I'm just going to help you a little bit. Very good. Amen. But we talked about, amen, we talked about last week Samuel and his call. And then we talked about Amos and his call. And I want you to understand the end result of the two characters was, it doesn't make no difference if you've been going to church all your life or God just took you off the corner. He can use whoever he wants to use. I need everyone to understand that. There's no need of saying, I don't know how that was going to be, no prophet. And they just got off of alcohol 4 years ago. Well, what did you just get off of? Or are you off yet? So we need to be careful about how we think we can choose who God should and should not be. Samuel was brought up in the house of God. Amos was sitting on the tree, minding his own business. But God chose him, and God used them. Amen. I want to say again to everyone on social media, wherever you are in your life with God, don't let nobody punk you out that you can't be used because you're not in the pulpit, you're not one of the limelight people, or what, all that kind of crazy. If God want to use him, get yourself set with him, and he because it is full of goodies and it is power packed. Tonight we want to talk about the prejudice process. Tonight we'll be talking about the prejudice process. No, you didn't mistake what you heard. I didn't stutter. I didn't make a mistake in my words. Tonight we're going to talk about the prejudice prophet, and we will be in the book of Jonah on tonight talking about this prophetic anointing, and also tonight we won't only talk about the prophetic, we're going to talk about how pathetic some people can become. Amen. And so, tonight, without reading, we're going to begin our journey in this lesson. Amen. There was a prophet in the Bible, has a book named after him. Prophet has one assignment that we read about in the scriptures. God wanted this prophet to go to a particular place and prophesy and tell them to get themselves together, or else he was going to burn the whole city down. And the prophet was present. He did not want to go down to this particular city and tell the people, or more or less tell the king, what the Lord has said to spare their life. And so we're going to start right there. We want to take it little by little and give you much as we can on tonight. Now I already gave you the name of this prophet, Jonah, J-O-N-A-H. And so we want you to follow along with us tonight as we deal with the prejudice prophet. Now, first question I want to ask tonight from those that are here on our panel, when you hear the word prejudice, what is your definition of the word prejudice? Please do not go on the internet. Don't open no books. I want to hear what your personal definition of prejudice is. Hey, let's start. Go ahead.
Well, when I think of prejudice, there are two things that come to mind. One, the person who is condescending and judgmental, and two, the person who is discriminatory, trying to play God.
All right, Kimmy Kim.
You want to know what does prejudice mean?
Yeah, no, I don't want you looking at what is the name prejudice? What does prejudice mean when you use that word?
When I think of prejudice, I think about just liking someone based on what you heard and not getting to know that person, or just having a, you know, you already made up your mind who that person is based on the things that you see without any factual information to back it up.
Okay. So from what both of you have just said, was somebody else on the line trying to say something? Okay.
Okay.
I thought there was somebody else trying to talk. But here's the truth of the matter. That word prejudice in a simple definition, it speaks of ignorance. Prejudice, I want people to know tonight on this call, on this podcast, in whatever way you have connected yourself, prejudice has been misinterpreted as a skin color problem. When the truth of the matter is that prejudice really should be interpreted ignorance or stupidity. When we look in the Bible, prejudice did not start because of black or white, Hispanic or Asian, Mexican or Hispanic. It did not start over that. Prejudice started in a family. Uh-oh. Go back and read your Old Testament. The first sign prejudice happening happened within a family of the Old Testament descent and scriptures. They begin to be against each other in the family in a prejudiced way, and then it begins to spread amongst their people, and here we are in 2021, and prejudice happening is still alive after all this time. And then we have folks who keep it stirred up because they are ignorant. And most of them that's keeping it stirred up is keeping it stirred up as a color problem. But it's not a color problem. It's an ignorance problem. I'll use this, but I don't want to get on a black history ride tonight. But when the first slave came over, they were from Nigeria, and their nickname was Niger. But because the so-called slave owners were so ignorant, they began to use the word nigger. And that's how that word begins. The actual saying was, these are Niger, meaning people from Nigeria. These are Nigers. It was that other race that started that word nigger because they didn't know no better. So that's a Black History moment for you in the midst of what we shall talk about tonight. And even that word nigger means, if you look it up, ain't nobody cussing on the line. Y'all need to grow up. Ain't that, that word nigger means stupid, ignorant, unlearned. When the truth of the matter was that the slave owner themselves were ignorant, stupid, and unlearned. Or else they would have known that the word was Niger, not nigger. as we move in this session, within that family, prejudice begins to rise in the midst of the family over idiosyncrasies that really meant nothing. They made it a big deal. Now, when we look at this prophet named Jonah, he was told to go preach to a city or a place called Nineveh. Somebody please talk to us about Nineveh.
Jonah 1, beginning with verse 1. Now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa. And he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind into the sea. There was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid and cried every man unto his God and cast forth the waters that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. So the shipmaster came and said unto him, What meanest thou, O sleeper? Arise, call upon thy God, if so be that God will think upon us that we perish not. And they said, every one to his fellow, Come, let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this evil is upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell upon Jonah. Then said they unto him, Tell us, we pray thee, for whose cause this evil is upon us. What is thine occupation? Whence comest thou? And what is thy country? And of what people art thou? And he said unto them, I am an Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, which made the sea and the dry land. Then were the men exceedingly afraid and said unto him, Why hast thou done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then they said unto him, What shall we do unto thee, that the sea may be calm unto us? For the sea wrought and was tempestuous. And he saith unto them, Take me up, cast me forth into the sea, so shall the sea be calm unto you. For I know that for my sake this great tempest is upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to the land, but they could not, for the sea was wrought, and the tempest was against them. Wherefore they cried unto the Lord and said, We beseech thee, O Lord, we beseech thee, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not upon us innocent blood. For thou, O Lord, hast done as it pleased thee. So they took up Jonah and cast him forth into the sea, and the sea ceased from her raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice unto the Lord and made vows. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. The word of God for the people of God.
Amen. Now, let's go back to this question, and I want to open up some things for you. We're going to look at this great city called Nineveh. And we want to show you Matter of fact, when you study out, about Nineveh was compared to Sodom and Gomorrah. They said that Nineveh was a city that had become wild and illicit and tricky and dirty. And when I say dirty, I'm talking about low down stuff was going on in Nineveh that was against God. I mean, sure enough, against God. It was, as a matter of fact, when you study it out, they were a city that really knew God at one time. But they allowed themselves to begin to take on what I will say, they allowed themselves to take on spirit. And those spirits took them into another world, took them into another way of acting, another way of displaying themselves. And God got tired of it. There is some people of God, just like we read tonight about Nineveh, don't you think this is the same thing that's going on even now with Corona, that God is trying to talk to us and tell us, I'm sick of your ways, I'm sick of your doing? Amen. And the prophets are crying aloud, even in this hour, trying to get the people to see that God is not playing. Somebody talk to me. Did everybody go to sleep?
I'm sorry, I was on mute. I apologize. But whenever God sends a message, it is God's intent that the messenger gives the message without fail, and certainly without preference of who the message goes to. And so when I think about this prophet really was bold to think that he could do something differently than what God had requested and or had required. He was bold to do his own thing. And that, I believe, was more dangerous and treacherous than him even fooling with a rattlesnake, in my estimation.
I want to jump the flip side of that coin to the city of Nineveh. Well, of course I made it. I'm preparing to go to work, so it takes a minute. Primarily, and I heard you say that Nineveh was basically in comparison to Sodom and Gomorrah, and I don't want anybody to think that homosexuality wasn't – Sodom and Gomorrah had – their major problem was homosexuality, but they had a multitude of other sins. For anybody that may not have known, I had the chance to kind of look that up some time ago. We found out that the spirit of Molech – and if anybody knows anything about that demigod Molech, it was a god that they used a hollow statue where they would literally sacrifice babies. Up to say babies that were 6 months old were put on this thing. It was heated up. We put coals and fire and things in it, and when it got to a certain temperature, they would sacrifice babies thinking that they were making a sacrifice to their quote-unquote gods. They came to – some of them came into the family of God because there were some Jews there. Now, the reason why I went to the flip side was we see the compassion of God, but we also see that the mercy of God does have the ability to run out at some point. And so he puts Nineveh in a position, you know, when the prophet or when the evangelist gets there, either you repent or you're going to die. Now, we understand what that means today for us. All I'm simply saying is on the flip side of that coin, God's compassion and God's mercy are on display here as well. Jonah's hard-headed, stiff-necked, wants to do his own thing, but Nineveh at the same time is the reason why Jonah has to make that trip because of their foolishness. That's all I'm going to add to it.
All right. So in comparison to today, what would we say is the most straight shot that we can give people on the line today to show them what Nineveh was like? What cities will we compare it to today?
A combination or cross between New York City, Las Vegas, Reno, Miami, parts of Atlanta, parts of Los Angeles. Well, you can't really pick one because each one has their own specific problem. And please don't let me forget Chicago. And no disrespect to those cities I mentioned, I said a resemblance of parts of those particular cities. Because, I mean, each one, for instance, you got the gang wars in L.A. You got homosexuality, which is running rampant down in Atlanta. New York City is a melting pot for sin and anything else you could find. And we need not even mention Las Vegas or Reno. We know what that is.
All right, so you have given us, Pateman, several viewpoints that we can understand what we are looking at dealing with when we say Nineveh. Let us not forget in that list of places that you called, Nineveh was also compared to Las Vegas. Nineveh was the big party town where everybody wanted to go for jolly time. They go down there. As a matter of fact, Nineveh was almost like the Mardi Gras. Go down there, you can do whatever you wanted to do, and then leave there and act holy. Uh-oh, sound like some folk today. Ain't time, come in. Nobody knows your best. You done been out doing your thing. And then you think you can come to the house of God and put on your show and nobody's supposed to know. Oh, but thank God, God has those seven eyes that sees all and he knows all. So we've got a viewpoint on where God was sending Jonah. And it looked like, as the prophet of God, I need to make note of that. Before we go too far, I need you to make note that in this week's story, this is not a man being called to become a prophet. Jonah was already the Lord's prophet. He was already in prophetic measure. He was already walking in the call. So when he gets this call from the Lord to go to Nineveh, all of a sudden there's a problem. He don't know how to obey God. on this call. But the Bible says instead of going to Nineveh, he goes the opposite way and goes to Joppa. From Joppa, he's going to jump on the ship and go to Tarshish.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody please tell me, because this was not just a preacher taking a boat ride. This was not just a preacher that forgot before he go to Nineveh. He forgot on his book. He had a revival in Joppa. He had another revival in Tarshish. What was the real situation here of this prophet who was already called, who was already doing the work? What is going on here? Somebody talk.
The other thing that we may not have paid attention to, and I'm sorry, Apostle Whitlow, just let me throw this in there. You got to remember, and I can't remember the actual date, the Samaritans and the Jews had a falling out, and there were a sizable amount of Samaritans in Nineveh during that time. Jonah had what we would call a racial discrepancy with the city of Nineveh because of its occupants. He did not want to go down there and minister to them because he didn't feel they were worth ministering to. Oh boy. What do we say about some folk today? It doesn't matter if you red, black, white, yellow, brown, green, blue, purple, purple, plaid, stripe, whatever the case may be. The Bible says, go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel. A lot of times the gospel's preached to a select few. If you my skin color, I'm going to preach to you. If you're a little darker than me, I'm going to lie to you and throw a circus at you, pitch a tent, hope you buy into it and give me all your money. Then I'm leaving town after I get finished with your foolish behind. I'm sorry. That's extra. That's earnest one and one. That's got nothing to do with anybody's salvation. But the truth of the matter is Jonah had a strong dislike. You might as well call it a minor hate for the city of Nineveh. And he did not want to minister to them because he didn't think they deserved to be delivered, to be saved.
Wait a minute, because if you say that and you put it out there like that, then are you trying to tell me that the president's preacher is still alive in 2021?
Oh, and in living color, got the nerve in some cases to be on TV.
It's because when you think about it, we still have the Pentecost that don't want to preach at the Baptist church. You got the Baptists that don't want to preach at the Methodist. You got the Methodists that don't want to preach for this one and that. So are y'all trying to tell me tonight that the president's preacher is still alive and walking around today? Talk to me, Whitlow.
Absolutely. Because we are in a time, unfortunately, where a lot of preachers think it's all about them. They are better than everyone. They're the only one who can hear from God. God is only talking to them, and God only moves when they move. God only speaks when they open their mouth, and so on and so forth. Yeah, they exist, and I agree with Bishop Desmond. You know, you got this one don't want to be there, that one don't want to be here. You know, it's just so chaotic in today's time. No wonder people don't want to even listen to what a true prophet has to say because they're so sick and tired of the ones who are faking the funk.
Now let me share this with you tonight to give a little light on this message. I was sitting at the college, at the Joint College of Bishops a couple of years ago when they did this workshop on the church and its expansion. And so the facilitator was teaching a wonderful job and begin the down of denomination. And so he started out, as you know, from the great Azusa Street move and begin to walk it on down. And, you know, they're listening. And when he got down, I'm showing you how people are prejudiced and don't even know it. When he got down to the Baptist movement, he began to show how the Baptist movement came about and all this. He said, and then the Baptist movement, about 70 different organizations. All the Pentecostals were just laughing and carrying on at the Baptist. So he went on down. He said, and then we had the Pentecostal church, who then broke up into about 300 different organizations. The room went silent. The truth of the matter is, I don't care what denomination has come about and how many of them there are. There's some prejudiced preachers in every organization. And tell you the truth, that's why organizations break up, because of prejudice. Somebody don't believe this. Somebody do believe this. And it becomes a main argument, just like you got organizations now still want the women to put dollies on their heads. And then the other part broke up because they didn't think it was necessary to wear the dollies anymore, because the Bible says, long as the woman had hair, that was her glory. And they fought over that and became two different organizations over hair something. How stupid can you get? And then here we read in this text, and Rich hit it real good. Here we have a preacher that don't want to go preach because he has a personal ought against the people. Prejudice spirit will cause you to behave in a very ignorant manner. It'll make you act like a fool when God has put an anointing on your life. The nerve of this preacher. And then he not only receives an assignment, but chooses on his own, I'm going to go away from the assignment, as though God was not where he was going. Come on, talk to me, Kimmy Kim, say something.
Well, you said something that was very so true. You have so many denominations who don't want to worship with each other. But we call ourselves children of the Most High God. But I'm still reminded, if you have this battle against someone because of who they, what they represent, like their denomination, shame on you, because God is not concerned about the denomination. He's more so concerned with, do you know my son, Jesus Christ? What have you done in my name? Have you fed the hungry? Do you go and visit the sick? Do you give to the needy? What is your gospel like? Or is it just more so of a show so that people can believe that you are a child of God? And so when I do see that, it's very disturbing, because at the end of the day, man-made customs won't get into heaven. What will get you in heaven is knowing your Jesus Christ. And through Jesus, you must have that love. So if you love someone and you don't want to worship with them because you have differences on your beliefs, that is not a good sign of love, because love bear all things, hope all things, endure all things. And when you have love, you can set aside your differences and just focus on the main purpose and the main core, which is Jesus Christ. But unfortunately, like you mentioned, we do have those who, you know, don't tend to either preach or teach or attend other, and that's your prerogative. But at the same time, we are called to be united, or we're called to be in the form of unity among each other, because we are brothers and sisters in Christ. And so it's very sad sometimes to just see the bickering over, okay, that's your prerogative. You don't want to, you know, eat meat, or but don't come over here and telling me that you're being sinful because you're eating meat or your makeup or your pants. God is not concerned with that stuff. Of course you want to be conservative and modest and carry yourself in a way that, you know, is pleasing to the Lord, but what he's really looking at is your heart.
All right. You agree with that, Apostle Window?
I absolutely do, and I think that Dr. Kim spoke very well. So, yes, I agree. Amen.
So, here we are. This is a major, major problem. And I'm so sad that it yet exists today. But this is a major and sad problem, even in the body of Christ, still today. And it's not just black and white. It's not just Hispanic. It's not even just denominational. It's just outright stupidity of preachers that feel like I'm better than somebody else. And since we are talking about prejudice tonight, amen, we want to talk about, we always talking against black and white prejudice, but how can you talk against black and white prejudice and you don't want to fellowship with the church right across the street because they're not of your sect? You don't want to go preach over at this church because they don't hop on one foot like we do. We got so much, we have so much stupid stuff that we are following in this day and hour until it has separated us and got us look crazy. Not crazy, crazy. We look crazy to the world. We look crazy to those that we're trying to win. We're going to tell them, come on in to the house of God where you can find a family, you can find a friend, and we don't even get along ourselves.
Well, Apostle, that kind of answers a lot of the question to why generations X, Y, and Z don't want to do church as we know it today, because of those very things that were brought up. And I applaud Sister Kimmy Kim, Dr. Robinson, for what she brought up, because, I mean, she just basically told the raw truth of where we are. Now, maybe our generation didn't start this madness, but our generation can certainly end this madness. The challenge and question here now is, are we going to take the advice of Paul as he spoke to the Corinthian church and let there not be schisms and divisions among us? Or are we going to just keep on going business as usual? We got choices to make. And, I mean, Jesus is soon to come. And if anybody pays any attention as to how the Lord Jesus is coming, you can go to Acts when he was ascended up into the heavens. The angels told those disciples how Jesus was going to return. What was the state of the church when Jesus ascended? They were in a state of unity. Am I wrong or right? So do we honestly think that Jesus is going to come back for a divided church? If he's coming back for the Methodist, I better hurry up and become Methodist. If he's coming back for the Baptist, I better hurry up and become Baptist. I just thank God he's coming back for a church without spot nor wrinkle. So I don't have to be Methodist. I don't have to be Baptist. I don't have to be Episcopalian. I don't have to be any of those denominations. All I have to be is saved and part of the body of Christ. That's all I wanted to add to that mix.
Well, but since you brought that up, isn't it funny? He's not coming back for any of that, but we keep trying to uphold all of that.
Well, here's the thing.
This practice thing is so stupid until we even got people claiming that our organization is the only one going.
Well, of course, Apostle, a lot of that comes from self-centered individuals who, again, think that they are the only ones who hear from God, that God only revealed his word to them and them alone. God anointed them and them alone. It's all about them. That's why that is an issue in today's time, because we have people who are seeking to be glorified and they want God to be ignored. They want to be exalted, but they want God to be dethroned. And I'm sorry, but God is not giving up his throne for anyone, no matter who it is, no matter if they are Baptist or Pentecostal or Apostolic or Presbyterian or Methodist or Episcopalian, or if they are Catholic or Jehovah Witness or some Jew or some Samaritan or some Gentile or somebody else. God is not going to stop being God for anybody. And anyone who does not understand that is certainly on their way to hell. For he is God, and he is God alone. Above him there is no other. There will be none before him, none after him, none beneath him, none above him. For he alone is God.
And see, what we must do in this hour, fail this spirit. We cannot promote it. We cannot push it. Because it is out of God's will that we push a certain way, a certain bishop, a certain apostle, whatever it is that's going on that has us all decided, has us feeling like I'm going to preach to my own, and that's it. We have gotten so down until we have pastors that don't do nothing but preach at their own church.
Mm-hmm.
We don't go out. We don't go out and intermingle with people. We don't fellowship no more. And if I do take an appointment for a fellowship, it ain't nobody but me and my wife. How are your people going to get to know other saints if you're going to keep them at home all the time? This prejudice thing, it works in more than one way, even though this scripture focuses in on the prophet. But in our time, it hurts us in more than one way. Because then the people start acting foolish and saying foolish stuff. Or we don't go over there because they ain't as good as us. Well, who said so? Can I tell you what the scientist said? The scientist said if all of us were deduced to a clump of dust, ain't none of us worth more than 39 cents. So who's the greatest? You might have a church with 50,000 people, but if they deduce you down to third, you ain't for worth 39 cents. So who's the greatest? This is why we need to keep God as the great. follow him. Now, Jonah is on his way towards Joppa. From Joppa, he plans to jump on a ship and go to Tarshish. Now, what is the scenario saying to us? That a prophet of God will receive an assignment and purposely go the wrong way. What do you have to say, Prophet Whitlow, about the relationship between the prophet and his God and the assignment that's put on him?
Well, in my opinion, anyone who calls himself a prophet and can blatantly do what they want to do after God has given them specific instructions, that individual is letting people know that you really shouldn't listen to me because I don't even receive instructions from the Lord, no matter what he says. It is a pride that is most dangerous, because what you're doing is you're saying, God, I'm really going to be my own God, and nothing you tell me is going to make me do anything different, see anything different, or act any different, because I'm going to do what I want to do because I'm me. That's literally what it says. That is so dangerous. I think that prophet who does that is most likely on their way to hell without any assistance from anyone or anything. That's just me.
Well, now, Jimmy Kim, he buys a ticket, getting ready to jump on a journey so-called away from God's assignment. What do you think about that? A man buying a ticket to get away from God's assignment. Talk to me a minute.
Well, I really believe he still gives us free will. Now, do he still lose his salvation? That's a good question. I believe salvation can't be lost once you give your life over. And I really believe that God allows things to happen when you become disobedient. And so, I mean, I'm going to be honest, there are times back in my 20s when I did want to do my own thing and I didn't, totally commit to myself to the Lord in my early 20s. And so I could have been that particular person. So it just depends, because, you have some people, they have, not given their life over to the Lord. And I would say, yes, they will probably not receive the gift of eternal life. However, you have those who are on unstable ground. Their soil is not as firm as because of their growth. And so sometimes I really believe that God gives them, get their attention by allowing things, even though it still rains on the just and unjust. But I really think he goes after the souls who he knows can do better, and so he causes things to happen. That's just my imagination, that I do find that people who give their life over to the Lord, they try it and they, quit. But I really believe that salvation is something you don't lose when you repent compassionate heart. And it's kind of hard to lose that salvation. So that would be my question. It just depends on where that person is when they walk away.
Okay. Pastor Whitlow, is it possible that the prophet had to at some from the presence of the Lord. If I fly to the utmost, he said, if I make my bed in hell, he said, and I'll say to that, if I go to the east or the west, he is there. So where was this prophet going if he thought buying a ticket was going to get him away from God's assignment? Talk to me.
Well, again, it shows that this is an individual who is bold enough to try God. Now, I believe in the questionable song that says, have you tried Jesus? He's all right. But I think that's in the sense of seeing that he is as good as the scripture shares with us. But this is the slang term, you know, about trying God, you know, as if, hey, I'm bold enough, big enough, bad enough, and most of all, grown enough to do what I want. And it really says to me that the prophet really did not fear God, which is dangerous because of a position, because of a title, because of a gift, to think that you have actually arrived, that you can disobey God, is exceptionally bold. Not only is it exceptionally bold, it is unfortunately quite stupid. And such stupidity will land you in places that you don't want to be. For instance, you know the law tells you don't do this, the law tells you don't do that, and you do it anyway. Now, when you get caught, you're mad, and then you want to ask yourself, what was I thinking? Well, you knew what you were thinking when you did what you did to get where you got, because you did what you did. And so here's what this individual is doing as a prophet. He's thinking to himself, you know, I ain't got to worry about what God gonna do, because God, let me tell you something, don't ever think that because you are a prophet, that God won't take you out for your disobedience. God has no problem taking you out. God has no problem cutting you off, because God will raise up a tree to walk in obedience if you refuse to. So this dude, being a prophet, choosing not to obey God, was literally, it was almost the same as he was signing his death warrant, in my estimation. He was saying, Lord, go ahead and kill me, take me out, I don't care, because I don't want to do what you called me to do. And I think there are some instances where it's just simpler to just do what is right rather than to deal with the consequences. And in this case, I don't care if I had an ex-girlfriend there, I don't care if I had an ex-wife there, an ex-lover or whatever, if God told me to go there and tell them what he said, I got to get over what I feel, get over what I think, and say what God said, and be done with it. I ain't going on that, man. I ain't going to try God like that. That ain't the way I want to try him.
So he was buying a ticket to go from God. Watch this now. He was buying a ticket to go from God, and didn't know he was getting ready to run right into God. But watch this now. But this time, he was going to run into God's anger. And as the word tells us, it is dangerous being the hand of an angry God. Matter of fact, that scripture says, you're better off being in the hands of man than to be in the hands of an angry God. Man might mistreat you. Man might talk about you. But as you just said, Apostle, God can wipe you out. Wipe you out and then raise up somebody unheard of to do it better, stronger, and longer, and just smile about it, and don't even think about the fact that you're gone. Because really, at the end of the day, how God interacts with us. And the way we choose that is through own obedience or disobedience. And the more obedient we are to God, the closer and better he want to deal with us. But when he sees that we are just hard-headed, stiff-necked, half-crazy, he'll start allowing things to happen not to hurt us. He'll start allowing things to happen to try to pull us in. Sometimes we just don't get it. So he jumps on the ship. And the first thing that started happening when they get out in the midst of the sea, a storm comes up out of nowhere. God got a way of getting our attention. And this storm was so crazy until it's just rocking and reeling the boat. And the water's coming in the boat. They started throwing stuff overboard, trying to save themselves. And then they looked over to the side. Jonah, with all that's going on, got the nerve to be asleep. I guess I better ask the question right here. Can we get so far out of God as prophets, as those anointed by God? Can we get so far out of God that we become comfortable even when it becomes dangerous to be where we are?
I believe the word you're looking for is delusional. Because that's exactly where we go, to the state of delusion, where we think we're in safety, where we feel like we ain't got nothing to worry about. Don't worry. I believe the word is delusional.
Well, you know, I don't allow the word delusional on my show. I'm just kidding, but I'll tell you about it later. But I want you to understand that is true. You are only fooling yourself when you think that you're going to be able to do anything for what God says and call yourself going somewhere to get away from what he says and get away from the one that says. You must be, as Bishop Davis said, delusional, crazy, out your mind, El Loco, and whatever else I can think of. How do you think you can get away from a God or from the God who is everywhere? If he's omnipresent, then where are you going? Tell me, please. If the God we serve is omnipresent, why in the ham sandwich was Jonah going? What was he thinking about? What was he thinking?
That to me, that's evidence of the human mindset. A lot of us, and let's just be real about this. I mean, another great example we can have is some of us think we can do our dirt, get away with it, and nobody's ever going to know about it. We all know the story of David and Bathsheba. We need not get into it. We know the story of the prophet Nathan, who had to go tell David about his dirty mess, but he had to be tactful in the way he did it. All I'm simply saying is the all-seeing eye of God, you're not, he ain't going, there's nothing that's going to happen. God knows what you're going to do before you even do it. Anybody that knows how many hairs I have left in my head, even after I've combed my hair and then ran the brush through it, and he still knows I've got 579,620 hairs. Oh, I'm joking on that part. But nonetheless, the bottom line is you're going nowhere fast. Your human mindset is under the delusional thought process that I won't be found. Okay, so how'd that work out, Jonah?
Well, no, you got anything you want to add to that?
I think that Bishop Designate said it. The reality is that you can't think that for you cannot think you're gonna outsmart God. You cannot think that God doesn't see, he doesn't know, or that he's not aware. He is tuned into everything before you do it, before you think it, before you act upon it. The Bible says that he's acquainted with all your ways. So don't think that because you are a prophet that you have special privileges that God will just let you pass. Oh, let this one slide, God. Come on, let this one slide. You know I'm your prophet. Because the Bible tells us that there's going to come a time when you stand before him and go say, Lord, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and so on? And he's going to say, depart from me, you work of iniquity. I never knew you. Because those who know him, they obey him. Those who know him, they keep his word. Those who know him, they follow him. Those who know him, they do what he says. Point blank, period.
Okay. Let's go a little further. So, the storm has come. The boat is rocking. They're throwing stuff off the ship, trying to save the ship. They finally go over to this sleeping nut on the ship, just rocking and rolling, and the water's coming in. They throw us up off the ship. Now here's this nut up there asleep. He's comfortable in his disobedience. Oh, my Lord. I have to deal with that another time. He's comfortable in his disobedience and sleeping on his assignment. And when they wake him up, he starts talking and says, I know why the storm is here, because I don't have no business on this boat. Now, I don't know about y'all, but if we're out in the middle of the water and a crazy storm going on, and somebody starts saying, this storm is because of me, I think the conversation is already over. Because, brother, I'm feeling like we get ready to die, and you wake up still wiping junk out your eyes. But I know what the problem is. It's me. Wait a minute. We all on here feeling like we about to die. We putting all the imports in the water because we thinking we need to save the ship. But the real problem is you. And we losing money throwing the water.
And you know what, Apostle? You're saying something there. Your disobedience can cost others.
Uh-oh.
Every single time. Disobedience. Now, I heard you talking. I heard talking loud and saying something. Our disobedience can be detrimental to other people. even if we don't think so, first thing we'll holler is, I'm minding my own business. I ain't bothering nobody. I didn't touch nothing to nobody. But because you're in the wrong place at the right time, the person who's to receive the blessing that's supposed to come from your hand is left destitute because of your disobedience. And now you done caused them. And let's just paint a quick scenario here for those who are listening by way of radio. God is using you, blessing to Brother George, who's been trying to call you all day because he's $50 short on the rent. And if he doesn't get it to the landlord by 5 o'clock, he's going to be evicted the next day. George calls you and leaves a message. I got to talk to you. Emergency, man. It's an emergency. I ain't got time for George. I ain't studying George. Then the next thing you know, you come by 2 days later to knock on George's door to find out what he wants, only to see that the house is empty. Well, thank you for being disobedient and not listening to the voice of the Lord. Poor George is in a homeless shelter because of your disobedient behind. I'm sorry. I just got to say it like it T.I. Eels.
Wait a minute. Let me put another step on that statement. Not answer the voicemail, but you look at the caller ID and knew it was him and still went out.
There you go.
That's how dirty it gets nowadays. They saw the name on the caller ID and still went out. And then they're going to come here to the house of God. Oh, we need to pray for Brother George. No, George needed money in prayer the other day. Now he needs.
And the scripture,
now he needs to take him in. He needs to
there
take
you go.
Him in.
The scripture says, "With not hold from them when it's in your power to do it."
You better believe it. Now,
there's the other thing, if I may. Because you know, Bishop Designate, you really opened up something. The prophet who ignores what God is calling him to and what God is saying is really the prophet who says, I'm not even concerned about your soul. I'm not concerned about your well-being. I'm not concerned about where you are in your life. I'm not concerned about what you're going to do, what you're going through, or anything. That's the individual who says, if it happens to you, then so be it. You probably deserved it. That is, you know, listen, that's the one who has no love and no kindness. That's the one who has no fear of God in his heart, because it's all about him, what he thinks, what he feels, and most of all, what he wants to do. That's why the Bible says that such an individual would be beat with many stripes, because of him is much required. Why? Because to him has much been given, you know. And here's one more thing I want to add, that when God gives the prophet message, timeliness is everything. Because if God gives you the message for that individual today and you wait until 2 days later, then what might have been a warning, what might have been a forecast, what might have been the preventative measure now has become an afterthought that has cost someone their life. And the worst thing that a prophet can do is cost someone their life. Not to mention, it's a terrible thing when that prophet is only out for his profit and not for the well-being of God's people. That's all I wanted to say.
I agree with that wholeheartedly, and I'm just thinking, while you're making that comment, or that statement, I should say, that prophet also had better recognize and realize that the blood of that individual, for whatever happens to them, is now officially upon that prophet's head. He now has to answer to God because of the demise of another, whether it's emotional, mental, spiritual, and even physical. And God is going to ask him, why'd you do it? You shouldn't have done it, George. You shouldn't have done it.
Now, let's look at this element. Because this is something people don't deal with while preaching this story. Jonah really was not trying to save the ship. Jonah became suicidal. That's how bad the prejudiced spirit was in him. He became suicidal. He said, I tell you what, if you want to live, throw me overboard. Jonah was so determined that he was not going to Nineveh. He said, kill me. Just throw me in the water. Guarantee you, whatever the problem is with this storm will stop if you just throw me overboard. Jonah became suicidal.
Well, now that you mention that, Apostle,
wow,
go ahead. Not only does he become suicidal, but he now becomes the reason why others die unnecessarily. And it makes you think about a lot of these preachers today who they're causing people to die unnecessarily, all because they refuse to walk in obedience to what God is saying. That is something heavy right there.
You're right. Now, I mean, you got three different levels of suicide for the preacher, for the prophet, whichever you want to call. Let's point out three quick people who sort of kind of had that same base mentality. Let's stop at Moses. When he had had enough of the children of Israel and God was getting ready to wipe them out, and Moses pleads with God, says, well, God, if you're going to kill them, you might as well take me out too. You might just kill me now. That's the mentality they come up with, preachers today. Just kill me now because I'm doing God's service, just because I'm sick and tired of doing what I'm doing. I mean, this is what becomes of Job. Elijah, another one. Great battle on Mount Carmel. A woman turned around and said she's going to have him dead by the end of the day. What does he do? He runs off somewhere. What's his words? Oh, just kill me now. I can't do this anymore. Jonah, without saying words, put the action to it. Y'all, just throw me overboard. Just kill me now, and you'll live. Interesting concept when you brought that up, Apostle.
And what it says, and what it really says is, hey, I'd rather die than to do what's right by the standard of God. Woe to those who are willing to die instead of walking the standard of God. If that doesn't concern you, let me tell you something. And I know, and this is designate, you should know this from the time I had you to come to Savannah. I've had a house rule for anyone who comes and ministers to me. My house rule is that if you don't obey God, we can't even as much as be friends. I would tell people, if God tells you to slap somebody upside the head and you don't do it, we can't even be friends. I cannot deal with somebody who will not obey God. I'm sorry.
No, you were good because, I mean, huh? Yeah, I'm going to leave that alone. I'm trying not to remember Savannah, okay? What happens in Vegas? No, I'm joking. Anyway, let's move on. Truth of the matter is, at the end of the day, the responsibility of the prophet is such, the magnitude of that responsibility is at a place and point where there is no time or no space for that individual to be wrapped, tied, or tangled in their own thought processes. It is not your business what God tells you to do. It is your business to do what God tells you to do. I'm sorry. Did I put a stopper in there? Let me pull the plug. I'm done. Hello?
Apostle, you still there?
Okay. Well, let's...
Amen.
move forward because, I mean, his call may have dropped. All right, but yeah, man. Like when he comes back, he'll jump back in. But yeah, I mean, what is it that we have such a difficult? Why is it that doing?
Hello.
And I'm gonna speak for me. Yeah, there you go, sir.
Okay, somebody had me muted and it knocked my phone out.
All right, so let's get the belt and let's head for St. Louis.
No, your phone dropped and you had to call back in, so I just unmuted you. Yeah.
I
say anymore.
No, I know. I thought he was doing a DM on us. A DTM.
When you drop it, call back in, your phone automatically goes on mute, so I have to unmute you. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Not only was he suicidal and was trying to get killed, or so he thought, final destination, but listen at this. When God wants you to do something, he's going to get you to do it regardless how you feel or whatever. It's that God prepared a great fish. Everybody's been saying the whale followed him up. But in recent history, they discovered that a man Jonah's size, there is no whale nowhere that has that size belt.
That's right. Boy, that's all right.
It said God prepared a fish. That means that this fish didn't even exist. God made this fish especially for Jonah. So, what I'm trying to get up to see is that even though we can catch up as the Lord's prophet, God has a redeeming mechanism already planned to bring us back where we're supposed to be, and he's not going to change his mind.
That's right.
If he told you to say it 2 days ago, 2 days later, without doing it, he still waits for you to do it. It's your assignment. We have said for years, if you don't do it, God will raise somebody else up to take your place. Maybe so, but not always. There are some assignments that God set in place for you and you only. And he's going to work on you and deal with you until you get assignment done. I don't know what makes people think they can lollygag and carry on and slow around. Oh, well, God's going to give it to somebody else after a while. And 2 weeks later, he's still talking to you. When you going to go do this? And things have started going crazy in your life and all of this, and you still thinking, well, God's going to give it to somebody else. Baby, I want to tell you tonight, he gave it to you. He packaged it for you. He meant it for you. The end of the day, when it gets done, guess who it's going to be? My God, I almost felt like hollering just then. So they throw him in the water, and the prepared fish swallowed him up. Somebody please tell me about Jonah's experience in this well. Oh, I'm not going to talk about a well. In this prepared fish. I'm only going to say one thing. and then I want somebody to take it. Jonah says, I ended up in hell. Somebody talk to me.
Apostle, I need you to know that Alfred done crept up in here because it's about 10 minutes after the hour.
Oh, my Lord. Alfred ain't doing too good these days. He put a tap me on the shoulder a while ago. He done got wrapped up in it. Well,
yeah.
I tell all of you, you're going to have to come back next week if you want to hear more about this prejudice preacher. And in the course of this, we're not just talking about the prejudice preacher. We're trying to warn you about your own prejudice self. Until next week, we'll talk to you again. The Lord loves you, so do I. And if you're catching hell, don't hold it. If you're going through hell, you better not stop. Go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. God has greater things in store for you. Shalom, shalom. Kimmy Kim, make it rock.